Good evening.
Good evening.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and it is not a church, and neither affiliated with any church or religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to proving the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, in the operation of eternal pattern, purpose, and plan operating through our journey unto this present day. Now, this school is a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. And we're incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Since that time, we have established private schools throughout the United States and various parts of the world. In turn, our school was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we use and teach by the true and originated titles for the Father, the Word, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It's been properly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It also been improperly substituted by God. And the true name for the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Now, Lord and God are titles, and they are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lords many and Gods many. But we now know each Lord must have a name, and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for Himself. Now, Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in the alphabet that would produce a sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are possible renderings for the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Now, Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, He's incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized in His pure spirit state on this chart as a cloud. Now, Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize Himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We draw this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the whole creation abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now, Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within Himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. Now, this shape and form can only be seen in the divine vision and understood in the divine revelation. Later on, this self-same spirit manifests Himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah. The world calls Him Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time He walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title could be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in the school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh Elohim led the children of Israel up out of Egypt, He called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. Now he instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. Also in this school, we go forth to prove that everything in the whole creation in the universe moves and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes this pattern. Now the 10 primary constitution objectives or aims of this tour as follows. One is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as it really is and actually exists. Two is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah. Without this, teaching of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, modern practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation of faith that was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning ordained, there is no other name given among men whereby man must be saved, save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan, speak the truth. Tonight we have a prayer by Dr. Irene Ramirez. Our scripture lesson is Hebrews 6th chapter. And our scripture would be Dr. Kenneth Kleinsmith.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
Yahweh, we would like to thank you again for gathering us here again tonight to learn about you and give us the strength to see it and give us the understanding and wisdom that we need so we get on in this world and we can see you in it and in us. We thank you in your son's name, Yahshua. Let's all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Trainer of the Scripture Research Association, reprinted by Yahshua Promotions, Hebrews 6. Therefore, leaving the beginnings of the doctrine of the Messiah, let us go on unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from works of death and of faith toward Yahweh. Of the doctrine of baptisms and of laying on of hands and the resurrection of the dead and of eternal judgment, and this we will do. This will we do if Yahweh permit. For those who are once enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift and were made partakers of the Holy Spirit, and have tasted the good word of Yahweh and the powers of the ages to come, if they shall fall away, it is impossible to renew them again unto repentance, seeing they crucify to themselves the Son of Yahweh afresh, and put him to an open shame. For the earth which drinketh in the rain that cometh oft often it, and bringeth forth herbs useful for them by whom it is tilled, receiveth blessing from Elohim. But that which beareth thorns and briars is rejected, and is nigh unto cursing, whose end is to be burned. But, beloved, we are persuaded better things of you, and things that accompany salvation, though we thus speak. For Yahweh is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love, which you have showed toward his name, in that you have ministered to the sons and do minister. And we desire that every one of you do show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope unto the end, that you be not slothful, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promises. For when Yahweh made promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no greater, he swore by himself, saying, surely in blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying I will multiply thee. And so, after he had patiently endured, he obtained the promise. For men verily swear by the greater, and an oath for confirmation is to them an end of strife. Wherein Yahweh, willing more abundantly to show unto the heirs of promise the immutability of his counsel, confirmed it by an oath, that by two immutable things in which it was impossible for Yahweh to lie, we might have a strong consolation who have fled for refuge to lay hold upon the hope set before us. Which hope we have is an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, and which entereth into that within the veil. Whither the forerunners for us entered, even Yahshua, not a high priest forever, at the order of Melchizedek. That was Hebrews 6. Let us all say, Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you. Good evening once again. Tonight's our workshop night. And without further ado, our first speaker will be the instructor for this evening will be Dr. Will Williams. It's good to see you folks here. Good to be here. You have to do that. I don't think about that stuff. Okay. You can hear me now?
Yes.
All right. I'll say this again. Good evening, class.
Good evening.
All right. Good to see you here. Good to be here. To learn more about this great, awesome panoramic vision bequeathed to us by Yahweh, our Elohim, to our founder, Henry Clifton Kenley, who set up this school of instruction. Okay. Are there any questions, comments? What's going on, Don? Y'all right over there? Y'all, you too quiet. When you too quiet, I have to get a suspect something.
I'd just be tired now.
Okay. That's understandable, and it's okay. Any questions, comments, or... Yes, ma'am.
Do you remember what you were, or did you actually go into it on Sunday? You said that you wanted to wait until Tuesday to go into it?
Oh, it was a particular subject, but Joe's not here. I'd rather wait
until he
is here.
Okay.
If he is here, if not, that's...
Okay.
I would rather refrain for the moment. But anything else is fair game, as far as I'm concerned. Did you hand up? Oh, no. Okay. Well, if not, then
We shall.
Oh, the infamous box.
What you got?
39.
Man, why are we putting all these? See, anytime you pull 38, 39, 40, you gotta pull all three of them because it's like a triad, sort of like, you know. 39, which is the new heaven and the new earth plane. That's what she pulled, 39. So now that means I gotta get 40 in play here. I gotta get 38 over here.
It's a new theme.
That's the plate you pull. New heaven, new earth state. Okay. Now, I have these two plates here because these three plates are kind of like, well, they're conjunctive. All right. They are together because one leads into another. That's basically it. Eschatology, science and things of the end. How can I introduce this? Let's start off with this. Genesis, I think it's the 26th chapter, or wherever Jacob's ladder is.
Genesis
28
and 12, or
did you go above that? 12, go above
that. What is it? 28, 12, 10, okay.
What does it say?
Well, 12, really, is where it started. That's why I was asking, did you want me to go
what
above
it? What does
it
say? It? I don't know.
And
he
dreamed, and behold, a ladder
set. No, go back up. No, then I
want 10. And Jacob went out from Beersheba and went towards Haran. And he lighted upon a certain place and tarried there all night because the sun was set. And he took up the stones of that place and put them for his pillows and lay down in that place to sleep. And he dreamed, and behold, a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to the heavens, and behold, the angels of Elohim ascending and descending on it.
Okay. Jacob laid down. Alright. Made a pillow and he laid down and he went to sleep, which is a type of death. And he was immersed in this dream. And then he was elevated in the spirit where he saw angels ascending and descending on this ladder. Okay? Now that's a principle. Ascending and descending. Okay? These plates, they do the same thing. They ascend and they descend as far as their flow of information. Just to give you an example. He gave a transgression plate. This is a descending plate. Why do I say that? The action starts here. Here's the woman being deceived by Satan. All right, this happened before they're cast out and she's having kids. So the flow of the story starts here and descends down. Whereas, on this plate, this is Noah. Mm-hmm. The action starts here, because Noah has to go out and preach to the four corners of the earth and warn the wicked, put blood on their head. And then he and his sons are working by the sweat of their brow. Here's the angel, giving them the instructions, the type of spirit, cup of holy anointing oil. And then they're going into the ark, it rained for 40 days, the windows of heaven are open. And then here's the ark on the mountains of Ararat. But this is an ascending plate. That's just a simple point I'm trying to make. All right. Now. Now. How do you play 31? Okay, I think I'm getting there. I am getting there. All right, now, to make this relevant, I'm introducing this, because really this is where you have to understand this to understand the rest of this. Okay, now, this is Yahshua's death, his burial, his resurrection. He tarried on earth for 40 days. All right, let's just read it. Acts, the first chapter.
Acts 1. The former treatise have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Yahshua began both to do and teach, until the day in which he was taken up. After that, he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days, and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of Yahweh. And being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, You have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days hence. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Rabbi, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And he said unto them, It is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own power.
Okay, now, come over here. Here they are. But see, they're assembled together. He's talking to them. Mm-hmm. Okay? And they're here on the Mount of Olives. Is where they're at, okay. I'll keep reading.
But you shall receive power after that the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses both unto me, both in Jerusalem, in all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, You men of Galilee, why stand you gazing up into heaven? This same Yahshua, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as you have seen him go into heaven. Then returned they unto Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is from Jerusalem a Sabbath day's journey.
Sabbath day's journey, okay. All right, stop here. All right. Now, Yahshua Messiah, He's gone through his death, burial, resurrection. Now, when he died, he came in the likeness of sinful flesh. And he was buried in Joseph's new tomb. But when he resurrected a quickening spirit.
Right.
Okay? Not a physical body, but a quickening spirit. All right? And he tarried on earth for 40 days. And then he ascended into the Father. In other words, he stepped on a cloud, and he ascended out of his sight. Now, we got the word vision written here, because that's what this was to them, a vision. Okay, because it wasn't a physical body that went up into the atmospheric heaven. Right. It was a vision that they saw within their minds, okay? Right. Yes.
If he was a quickening spirit, how come John could feel his hand?
Because he has the power of transmutation. You can instantaneously take on a body at will any time. It don't take you like, okay, hold on for a minute. It's going to take you about an hour to materialize.
Instantaneously.
You know, in and out, just like that. Mm-hmm. See? So, I mean, if you read the story, he ate a piece of broiled fish.
Yeah, that's right.
All right? But at the same time, in the same story, when you read, how did he kind of get into the room? You don't read him opening the door. He just appeared right through it.
Right.
Right.
You know, people forget about that part.
You
see? Mm-hmm. But that's the power of spirit. See, spirit has the power to take on a body, take off a body at any time, even before his death and burial and resurrection. When he was walking around in his ministry, there was a couple of situations where they were pressing up on him, and then he just disappeared right on and just walked through the crowd. He's like, wait, what happened?
Right.
See, he said, nobody take my life except when I lay it down. I lay it when I'm ready to do it, not when you think I should, or when you think you're going to do it. See, and that's the power of spirit, see. I take on a body, take off a body. It's no thing to him. Okay? So like right here, this is a vision. And see, he's stepping onto a cloud. See, let's just draw a line. Here's the high priest, on the Day of Atonement. He's got the censer in his hand. He's got coals from off the fire here, off this golden altar of incense, and he came from behind the veil. See, and he's flicking blood toward the mercy seat. But see, when he's enveloped in a cloud, he came up on a cloud.
Mm-hmm.
That's the point I'm making. So he's immersed in a cloud, all right? Just like back here, there's Yahshua immersed or enveloped in a cloud, just like the high priest. Okay, now come over here. This is eschatology, and it says the new covenant written in the heart and mind. Well, actually, before we get to that, see, the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the day of Pentecost, all right, where it wrote this new covenant in the heart and mind of all men. Okay, so Yahshua is in the hearts and minds of men. Okay, so now I think the scripture what I want, 1 Thessalonians. I think it's 1 Thessalonians. Yeah, 1 Thessalonians 4 and 13.
1 Thessalonians 4, 13. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Yahshua died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Yahshua will Yahweh bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the ruler, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of Yahshua shall not prevent them which are asleep. For Yahshua himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of Elohim, and the dead in the Messiah shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet Yahshua in the air, and so shall we be with him. Wherefore comfort one another with these words. But of the times...
Okay, that's good enough. All right. Now... that says that here's a new covenant written in the heart and minds of men. And it said, Yahshua shall descend with a shout. All right, that tells me this plate right here is a descending plate. Okay? And he's going to descend with a shout. Now, if he's here, and he's in the hearts and minds of men, see, that would be in the most holy place. That would be in the type of heaven. Now, if he's going to descend, and heaven is the seventh step, and he's going to descend, then the next step from seven would be six. Mm-hmm. And the sixth step is a veil. So the question you want to ask is, what is the veil principle in this plate? The veil principle in this plate.
Acts 17:24. Elohim that made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is ruler of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands.
Right, Yahweh. I think that you should look at the holy name sometimes.
That's what it says in the room.
Yahweh.
Oh, you mean Elohim?
What does it say in the holy name?
Yahweh.
Thank you.
Who made the world and all things therein, saying that he is ruler of heaven and earth. Mm-hmm. He dwelleth not in temples made with hands.
Read.
Neither is worshipped with man's hand, as though he needed anything, saying he giveth to all life and breath and all things, and has made of one man all nations of men for to dwell on all the face of the earth, mm-hmm. and has determined the time before appointed and the bounds of their habitation.
All right. Made of one man all nations of men to dwell upon all the face of the earth. In other words, all nations of men came from one man.
Right.
The man Adam. So that means that we are all, no matter what color, creed, caste that we, as human beings, we're all one flesh.
Mm-hmm.
Because we come from one man. We are one flesh.
Flesh.
In a physical sense, we are all one flesh.
Mm-hmm.
That's the veil principle here. Because, see, this veil, see, has to be rent. And so for this veil to be rent, once it is rent, see, angelic invisibility.
Mm-hmm.
Angelic invisibility.
Mm-hmm.
Passing through the veil. Angelic invisibility into angelic visibility.
Mm-hmm.
To be able to be seen in a vision.
Mm-hmm.
Angelic invisibility. Renting the veil of the flesh. Human beings. The physical. Renting the veil. Now to be able to see. All human beings be able to see Yahshua. In a vision, angelic visibility.
Mm-hmm.
Universal, because not just, look, this is me, mm-hmm. angels, demons, and souls.
Mm-hmm.
When I say universal, look, everybody will see this.
Right.
Dead and alive.
All of creation will see, all eyes will see this.
Mm-hmm.
See, descending down into this plate here. Okay? Immortality. See, Elohim revealed for them. See, look, here you are. You are in the Elohim, in Yahshua, because as Yahshua revealed, you are revealed in him.
Mm-hmm.
Where we at? We at Thessalonians? Maybe we
can.
How about, let's see. It was a scripture I was thinking. I thought it was in Thessalonians. Maybe not.
What are you looking for?
Taking flaming vengeance. Maybe I'm thinking of 2 Corinthians, perhaps?
Corinthians.
Okay. No, it's not. No, it's not. No, thank you.
First Thessalonians 8.
What?
First Thessalonians 8.
First Thessalonians 8? There's no such thing.
Second Thessalonians 1.
There's still no such thing. I don't know what you're talking about. What are you talking about, madam?
Second Thessalonians 1 and 8.
Thank you. No, you didn't. You said 2 Thessalonians 8.
No, I said 1 and 8.
Speak into the mic so we can hear you.
Inflaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not Yahweh, and that obey not the glad tidings of our Savior, Yahshua, the Messiah. Let me pick up the continuity.
Yeah, 7.
And to you who are troubled, rest with us, when Yahshua the Messiah shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels. And flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not Yahweh.
Okay, now taking flaming vengeance, taking vengeance upon them that know not Yahweh. Flaming vengeance. Now look, this is fire from above, so to speak. The veil's rent in vain, rent in twain, and fire from above, and then fire from below, alright, and folks caught in the middle. Now, what does that mean? Now, see, in other words, you are the lake of fire. See, I mean, if you are in Yahshua and he's taking flame and vengeance, then you are the lake of fire. See, that's going to burn everything up. Look, everything,
what does that mean, you are the lake of fire?
Yeah.
I'm getting there. I don't know why y'all so impatient. Now, I kind of went into this the other day. And in fact, a person, it was so ironic, because a person texted me and asked me this question, because it was a question that came up in another class or something. And they asked, where does the universe abide? All right, where does the universe abide? Mm-hmm. And folks had a couple of different answers and stuff. Some said it abides in the pure spirit state of Yahweh. That's what most people said, actually. No one really said that it abides in Elohim. Or, for that matter, you need to move the camera over because I'm pointing with this. There you go. Or that Elohim himself is the creation.
That's right.
See? He is both creator and creation.
Right.
Okay. Hence the mystery of the hydrogen atom.
That's right. Okay.
See, if you understand the hydrogen atom, then you'll understand Elohim, because he is the original hydrogen atom. And see, and that's the paper that Dr. Kinley wrote in comparative exegetical analysis, okay? And I didn't say this the other day because for some reason, I don't know, I got misdirected on a tangent. But when we went, Kinley and I went to Fisk University to try to find out about the degree, and we talked to the guy there, he had told us that the building where they had the degrees at, that they were given out at the time period that we thought Dr. Kinley may have gotten it, had been destroyed by a flood. And so all the documents had been washed, you know, away, all that kind of stuff. So they didn't have him, because he did look, because we were there for like a week, and he took like 2-3 days, and he called me back and all. And he, you know, that was the story he told me, so, concerning that, so. But still, to understand what Yahweh Elohim is and his makeup will help you to understand the devil or the mystery of iniquity and his imitation. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Right.
The universe. What is the universe? Let's determine that. What is the universe?
Mm-hmm.
See, the universe. Oh, it says Josie. Let me. We picked a number. Your girl over there.
I figured that out.
She did. She picked 39.
Okay.
Okay. Right. She picked, so then you know what had to happen after that. She picked 39.
Yeah.
Okay. So, and then in the course of explanations, a couple other things had to be brought up. So, but anyway, when we talk about the universe, we're talking about the physical and the angelic creation. Why? Because they are the two transmuted parts of Yahweh. Okay, they are his two witnesses, an incorporeal creation and a physical creation. Romans 1:19-20. I just get a couple of basic things in there that maybe we could apply a little bit.
Romans 1:19. Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them, for Yahweh has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and supreme nature, so that they are without excuse.
Okay, now that includes his supreme nature and his eternal power. His supreme nature is his threefold makeup. See, that is to say, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, these three are one. What does that mean? Well, he is pure spirit. That's abstract. But there's no way you can understand that.
Right.
So he transmuted himself into two distinct parts, an incorporeal creation and a physical creation.
Mm-hmm.
That is his eternal power. His eternal power is the power of transmutation. What do you mean? Because if he is eternal and he's creating ages, before and after, how do these ages come about? They come in by transmutation, and they go out by transmutation.
Right.
It's a power that Yahweh exercises eternally.
Right.
The power to transmute.
I got you. That's it.
See, that's what this is. And when he's transmuting, see, he's transmuting. This is a transmutation in part, not in totality, of pure spirit, of the attributes. This is him coming from behind the veil of inscrutability and incomprehensibility, i.e. the cloud. Because in this case, the cloud would be like the veil. And he's coming and he's stepping out from behind the veil. Or from behind the cloud. See? Alright? Now, theosophy. This is just an exposition of what he is made of. See? This and this is one of the same. This is something we can identify with because it's a point of reference. It's in the shape and form of a human being because that's what we are. And we can identify with this. Okay? But they're both the same. See, this is more accurate in the sense of what he really is an organization of attributes.
Mm-hmm.
In an organized state. This is the internal parts of spirit law. Alright?
Mm-hmm.
What this is showing you is the hydrogen atom. More so over here. Because here he is standing on the pavework of a sapphire stone.
Mm-hmm.
Isaiah 66:1.
Mm-hmm.
Isaiah 66:1. Thus saith Yahweh, the heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. Where is the house that you build unto me, and where is the place of my rest? For all those things...
That's good enough. See, heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. Mm-hmm. See, him himself would represent the angelic creation. The footstool of the earth will represent the physical creation. That's the hydrogen atom, or proton and the electron. Both of these is the same as this heart, which is in the midst of the invisible third part, which is spirit law, which is Yahweh. Mm-hmm. See? Here you are. This is why I say this. If you are made body, soul, spirit, your soul and your body emanates from the spirit that is in the midst of you. See. In the textbook, it talks about the 92nd atom. According to the periodic table, it's uranium. But Dr. Kinley called it that because he distinguishes the hydrogen atom from the other atoms of the elements of the periodic table, because they are clearly threefold, whereas the hydrogen atom appears to be twofold. So when you talk about the 91 elements, other elements, they're threefold. That's why we say proton, neutron, and electron. But the 92nd element would be, which is the hydrogen atom, would be an electron, a proton, and both of which are embedded in the invisible third part, which is spirit law. This is how Elohim is. Elohim, representing the angelic creation in this analogy, standing on the paved work of a sapphire stone, the earth, or the physical creation, both of which are embedded in the invisible third part, which is spirit, or the cloud, pure spirit, or spirit law. Because see, a lot of people don't recognize that pure spirit is spirit law too.
That's correct.
But you can't understand that in an abstract state.
No.
So it behooved Yahweh to move in a state that you could understand this at. This is Elohim. This is Elohim. This is spirit law. That's why the hearts are up here in the most holy place. That's him. They're one and the same. It's drawn out from him. There's this one. I'll give an illustration. There's this one illustration where it shows Elohim. I think I have it. Look down here to this. All right, you zoom in here on the holy place. You see, right? Maybe I should use my ink pen here. See this little line here? See, that's an incision there.
Mm-hmm.
See,
right.
So there's an incision there. See, showing for just like Adam, there was an incision with Adam. But but where did Adam get that from? Because there was an incision made in Elohim, the showing for the creation being drawn out from him. That's why it's there. It's represented there like that. Dr. Kinley drew it there like that to show you that the creation was in him. See? Okay. See? Or as he would say in one lecture, see, this is not a hollow thing. It has internal parts. See? Draw a line. Come over here. Here you see these angels up here. They're on the veil. The angels on the veil represents the angelic creation.
That's right.
The veils are within the tabernacle. Mm-hmm. Why so? Because to show you that the angelic creation exists within him. Mm-hmm. OK. Okay? So, going back here, as we started off, these folks here saw a vision. They saw Yahweh, they saw Yahshua stepping into a cloud. See, in a vision, in their consciousness, coming over here. See, the New Testament written in the heart and mind, coming down, as we read, descending from heaven with a shout, in here. The rending of the veil, that's the human race. Coming into a state of angelic visibility, just like over here. Angelic invisibility. Flaming fire, because you are that fire.
That's right.
You are the fire. You are the flames of fire. See, you're the lake of fire. Because see, what is the lake of fire? See, people think the lake of fire is just, oh, this is a little special place over here. No, that Yahweh himself is that lake.
That's right.
The whole universe came, wait, this is a lake of fire right here. The whole universe came out of a lake of fire.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So it's going back in. The question is, as we talked about in one workshop, you got your fingers right? How's your reentry?
That's right.
Everything's got to go back into a reentry.
Mm-hmm.
So the question is, you got your fingers right?
That's right.
How's your reentry? Because see, if you ain't got your fingers right, you'll burn up.
You'll burn up.
Right.
So you better get them fingers right. Mm-hmm. And it better not be hidden either. It'll be out in the open, nice and plain. See, and look, let's just. This is a descending plate. Yeah, I'll continue with that. He said, because see, immerse into the lake of fire. Well, let's look at it like John Glenn, the movie Hidden Figures, John Glenn. He was calling and saying, hey, I want to make sure I got my figures right. So he's going to make a re-entry. Now, if he's got his figures right, when he makes his re-entry, he's going to be all right.
He's going to be all right.
But if his figures ain't right,
that's it.
See, you see here, this number here, 666, mm-hmm. That figure ain't right.
Right.
That figure's not right. So it's getting burnt up. You get me? See, you gotta have the right figures. See, now if you're coming in with the figure 666, well, that's going to ain't the right figures. Mm-hmm. That's not the right figure to come into re-entry with. to re-enter Yahweh, that's not the right figure to come in with. Mm-hmm. See, because you'll get burnt up with that figure.
That's right.
Right. Now, here we got to come over here. This is descending. All right. Then we come over here. Renovation. And see, renovation, to renovate something means to make new. To make pristine. You know, as if, you know, to put it back into a state where there's no defect. You know, that kind of thing. And see, and the renovation of the earth. See, look, we got this word over here. Immortality. See, Elohim revealed from heaven. Okay, but let me say you something. You have immortality dwelling in a physical body as of right now. See, the problem is this physical body is ill-equipped to handle this immortality for a long period of time. Maybe for a short period, but not for a long period of time. It's like the scripture usually uses the expression new wine in old skins, that kind of thing. So now you got to renovate this old skin. Come up with something new. New heavens, new earth. Now see, now we have this illustration here. Now, it's only made that way as a point of reference because see, it's not something anybody has ever really seen. So we have it painted this way as a point of reference. In fact, it almost looks like a Garden of Eden. In principle, uh-huh. It is. In principle.
That's correct.
Because see, look, when the trans, let's read it. Romans 8 and 20.
Romans 8:20.
Mm-hmm.
For the creation was made subject
to.
No, the creature.
That's it. That's a big difference, see. Mm-hmm. For the creature, what creature, see?
Mm-hmm.
Her. how was she made finish that sentence.
For the creature was made subject to vanity.
Now, how was the creature made subject to vanity? She was made subject to vanity when the woman was taken out of the man. Mm-hmm. When she was taken out of the man, she was not under his subjection anymore. So she was made subject to vanity. Yahweh knew that. Mm-hmm. Yahweh understood that. Yahweh purposed that.
Right.
So that when he did do that, certain it set into motion certain things to happen.
There you go.
See? Set him up, because then he comes along. And then a transgression happens. But with that, keep reading.
Not willingly.
Not Eve, if it was up to Eve, she would have stayed in Adam, nice and cozy. Mm-hmm. Had it been up to her, she would say, oh, I'm cool where I'm at. But it wasn't up to her. Not willingly, but read.
But by reason of him who had subjected the same in hope.
Now, after the transgression happened, she became subjected to her husband. So when he was kicked out, and she followed him out. She followed her hope. Read.
Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of Yahweh.
Now see, the bondage of corruption, what do you mean? The world, human government, etc. The bondage of corruption. Because now, see, you're now married. See, look, you're out here, and look. Boy, I gotta put this. Keep reading, and I'll get to a point.
For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together unto now.
Mm-hmm.
And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body.
Mm-hmm.
For we are saved by hope, mm-hmm. but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for?
Mm-hmm.
But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it.
Okay, now she followed her hope out of the garden. All right? Talking about the man. See? Now Yahshua came along. All right? And I'm getting ahead of myself. Let me put this together properly. When the transgression happened, death passed on all men. And death reigned. Okay? And there was no law imputed at the time until Moses come along, and Yahweh, through Moses, gave the Hebrews 613 laws, statutes, and ordinances. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
This imputed sin. Alright? In other words, Yahweh married Israel at the mount. When he spoke down the Ten Commandment law from the mount, he literally married Israel. So when Yahshua is coming along here later in a physical body, this is the husband checking up on his wife in the physical flesh, talking about Yahshua. Because literally they were married to him. Okay? Through this law. Okay? Now, because of this law, nobody was able to perform it. Therefore, it behooved him to perform it for them and move it out of the way. Where's that scripture at? Is it 6 and 1? Romans 6 and 1?
Colossians.
No, Romans 6 and 1. Mm-hmm.
What shall we say then? No.
Okay. 7 and 1, that's what I want.
Okay. So, Romans 7 and 1. Know ye not, brethren, for I speak to them that know the law, how that the law hath dominion over a man as long as he liveth. Mm-hmm. For the woman which hath an husband is bound by the law to her husband so long as he liveth. But if the husband be dead, she is loosed from the law of her husband.
Okay, now, she's married, come out of Israel. She's married to Joshua through the law. Mm-hmm. Okay, and as long as he's alive, she is bound to this law as long as he liveth.
Right.
Read.
So then, if while her husband liveth, she be married to another man,
uh-huh,
she shall be called an adulteress.
Now, as long as he's alive and she does something else, then she's an adulterer. Because, see, she's cheating on him. Mm-hmm. Okay, read.
But if her husband be dead,
uh-huh,
she is free from the law.
Now, if her husband be dead, then she's loose from this law.
Right.
Read.
So that she is no adulteress, though she be married to another.
Though she be married to another. What do you mean? She was married to Joshua in the flesh. But then he died,
mm-hmm,
buried, and he resurrected a quickening spirit. Or in other words, he resurrected a new man. So that now Israel can be married to Joshua after the spirit and not after the flesh. Married to him after the spirit. Read that. Keep reading that.
Wherefore, my brethren, you are also become dead to the law by the body of the Messiah,
uh-huh,
that you should be married to another, even to him who is raised from the dead.
Read.
That we should bring forth fruit unto Yahweh. And when we were in the flesh, the motions of sin.
That's good enough. See, to be married. See, he's the new man that we should be married to. See, in the spirit. Yes.
Is that another way of saying that we are no longer under the law?
We were never under the law because we were Gentiles.
Uh-huh. I mean, the ones that were under the law are no
longer. Well, the Jews, they're not, well, see. Well,
but they don't believe he's come.
Well, see, they don't believe, they're still waiting on the Messiah. Uh-huh. So they rejected this one, uh-huh, and they're still waiting for a Messiah.
So do they follow the law?
As much as they can. Certain parts they can't, you know, they can't do. For reasons of logistics, I suppose, but the Passover, they still do the Passover, which in their minds is like a sacrifice, so they still do that. See, the ceremonies, circumcisions, baptism, you know, they do what they can. Okay? Now, here, it talks about a new earth state. Well, it has the scripture here. I may as well read it, but there's something else I was thinking. 2 Corinthians 5:16. That's the scripture that it has there in that caption.
2 Corinthians 5:16. Wherefore, henceforth know you no man, know we no man after the flesh.
Mm-hmm.
Yea, though we have known the Messiah after the flesh, yet now henceforth know we him no more. Therefore, if any man be in the Messiah, he is a new creature.
Mm-hmm.
Old things are passed away. Behold, old things have become new.
Mm-hmm.
And all things are of Yahweh, who hath reconciled us to himself by Yahshua the Messiah.
See, that's the whole thing. See, we just... It just confirm what we just said. Yahshua the Messiah, see, he's not after the flesh. He's a quickening spirit. So he's in the spirit. So therefore, those that come after him have to come after him in the spirit and not after the flesh. See, now, let's look at this in a micro view first. See, the renovation, see, here you are, and it's at the eschatology, or the eschatology of you, the end of you. See, that is to say, you being burnt up by this lake of fire, and seeing the renovation of your earth, the renovation of what earth, the renovation of these earthly concepts that you have. See, all of these, see, these things here, see, burning these things up and getting them replaced with these qualities and attributes. See. That's the renovation, the new earth state.
I see.
The new earth state. See, in your consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? See, and you going into the Sabbath, and all that is to say, you, because see, the whole idea of what the Israelites was, see, they went up here in Canaan's land, and they had to go down to a land they knew not of, and be subjected to bondage, but then they would come out with great substance, and would come back and receive their inheritance. That's the same way it is for us. We are receiving our inheritance, that is to say, and they receive their inheritance and they receive rest. Likewise, it's the same way with us. We receive our inheritance and our rest in our consciousness.
That's right.
See? Oh yeah, you still gotta get up and go to work if you gotta do that or do your little things around, you know, but in your consciousness, see, you have the rest because you look around you and you see everything for what it really is. Yahweh running things according to the pattern, according to spirit law. Okay? See? Now, here's the macro version of this. We can look at this through the ages. Because see, if Yahweh's declaring the end from the beginning, if everything came out of, quote unquote, a lake of fire, then everything has to go back into a lake of fire. The question is, what state and condition will you be in when you go back into that state? Really, you can only be one or two conditions. You can either be a minister of flames of fire, or you can be flesh. Now that's really the only two choices you have. You can either be a flame of fire or flesh. Now Yahweh is a consuming fire. You would think, you know, if you were faced, if you were going on a journey and somebody said, well, where are you going? And I said, well, I'm going to a place that's a lake of fire. And I said, well, what's the conditions of the survivors there? Well, the survivors there, you gotta be like a lake of, you gotta be like fire. Anything else is not gonna survive. They say, well, what about flesh? Well, no, I wouldn't advise flesh going there. It's not gonna make it. Now you would think, you know, if you knew that, then you would make the choice or make some sort of effort to condition yourself to be a fire, to be a fire form or something, you know? If that's where you knew where you were going, that was your ultimate destination. Rather than remaining a flesh, if you're like, well, I'm flesh, you know, but flesh is not going to survive fire. So, I mean, you would think, I said, well, maybe I should do something to maybe make a conversion of some sort, you know? See, that's the thing. Fire can't hurt fire. Mm-hmm. See, and look. Adam, the first Adam, Eve followed the first Adam out of the garden. So now if Eve followed Adam out of the garden, we read that she followed her hope, then you have to see over here on this plate. Eve following her hope back into the garden. In this case, pure spirit state of Yahweh. Following her hope back, which is the Sabbath here, which is the all in all, which is the seventh age. Then we should read that in the textbook. Page 93.
What volume?
Page 93. First volume, volume 1.
Volume 1, page 93.
Just read the boxes.
The ages are in the following order. The ages. 1, creative. 2, the antediluvian. 3, the post-diluvian. 4, the present or church age. 5, the kingdom ages, the perfect church ages to come, the sabbatical.
Okay, now, it said now, we're in the fourth age, which is the present kingdom, and then the fifth age, which is the kingdom, or the kingdom of immortality, and then the sixth age is called the perfect. Now, some people would say, wait a minute, I thought perfection was 7. It didn't say perfection. It said perfect. Can we look at the word perfect?
I
Because see, here, this is the end of the fourth age here. Going into the renovation of the earth, going into a newer state. This is a fifth age right here.
Perfect. Having all the required or desirable elements, qualities, or characteristics as good as possible to be. Synonym, ideal, model, without fault, flawless, consummate, quintessential, exemplary, best, ultimate, unrivaled, unequaled, matchless, unparalleled, utopian, incomparable, peerless, unexcelled, unsurpassed, unsurpassable, free from any flaw or defect in condition.
Now why does that puts us all right now, but why did Dr. Killia apply that word to the sixth age? Not the seventh age. Why the sixth age? Because of this reason. 1 Corinthians 15.
But now is the Messiah risen from the dead, and become the first fruits of them that slept.
Now here's the Messiah. He is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits. Here he is. He's the first fruits of them that slept. And he's risen a quickening spirit, a spirit man, not a physical man. He went in physical, but he came out spiritual. Okay, read.
For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead.
Now since by man came death, what man? The first man, Adam. But it also says by man came also the resurrection of the dead. What man? The second Adam. Yahshua the Messiah. Alright? The second Adam. Read.
For as an Adam all died, even so the Messiah shall all be made alive. But every man in his own order, the Messiah, the first fruits, afterward they that are the Messiahs at his coming. Then cometh the end, when he shall have to deliver up the kingdom to Yahweh, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and power. For he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. For he hath put all things under his feet. When he saith all things are put under his him, it is manifest that he is excluded, which did put all things under him. And when all things shall be subdued unto him, then shall the Son also himself be subject unto him, and put all things under him, that Yahweh may be all in all.
Okay, now when it talks about all things shall be subdued and put under his feet, that's Elohim. Because he's the one moving through the ages. Okay? Now you remember when we read in Acts, they were up here on the Mount of Olives. And then after Yahshua went out of his sight, stepped into a cloud and went out of his sight, they went back to Jerusalem. A Sabbath day's journey. Because it was a Sabbath day, you weren't supposed to be doing a whole bunch of work on the Sabbath day, not even a whole bunch of walking. But from the Mount back to Jerusalem was within the limits, or what they would call a Sabbath day's journey. Okay, over here. Here we have, we're in the fourth age here. Here's the fifth age. Here's the word Sabbath. Now some people get confused when they see the word Sabbath and say, wait a minute, it's in the fifth age. What's Sabbath doing in the fifth age? That's seventh, right? No, it's talking about a Sabbath of immortality, which is here in the seventh dispensation. Okay? So that's a sabbatical, so this is a sabbatical dispensation in the fifth age. So once we get to here, from the fifth age, which is a sabbatical, and the seventh dispensation, which is a sabbatical dispensation, then from the fifth age to the seventh age is a Sabbath day's journey. From one Sabbath to another. Because the seventh age is a sabbatical age. So from the seventh dispensation, a sabbatical dispensation, to the seventh age, a sabbatical age, is a Sabbath day's journey. Okay? So now likewise over here. It's the same way here. The new earth state. Because the new earth state here is the same as what I was pointing to over there, the seventh dispensation, the fifth age. That's here. The sixth the sixth age would be like the sixth step of the veil. Because see, Elohim, as we just read, all things must be subdued and put under his feet. Why? Because that's how it started off. Here it is right here. All things are subdued and under his feet before anything comes about. Because that's how he started off. So he's gotta end back up like this. When we just read that scripture in Corinthians, this is what you're looking at. This right here, in this spot right here, the sixth step. And then he's gotta make that entrance into the most holy place, just like the high priest did. And then Yahweh might be all in all. He's in the Sabbath. He's in the Sabbath. See? The seventh age, the sabbatical age. See? Keep reading. In the textbook.
Oh, the textbook.
I'm sorry.
The dispensations.
No. Read the
Sabbath.
Yeah.
Okay. The Sabbath is the day of Yahweh, or the day before the beginning of the age.
How come I can't hear you?
I don't know. It was so loud before.
Why don't you just get into the mic?
I am.
Now you are, because you're not close enough.
Well, I can't be that close and read and see. The Sabbath is the day of Yahweh, or the day before the beginning of the eighth, or the beginning of another series of ages. It is necessary to mention here that Yahweh is eternal. It is also necessary that you do as the Apostle Paul advised Timothy.
Okay.
Study the scriptures to show thyself approved unto Yahweh, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the dispensations and ages, the word of truth.
Okay. Now, it's the Sabbath age. Okay, now, the Sabbath, see, this is the before the eighth age. This is the sabbatical age here. And this is the eighth age here, because this is him stepping out from behind the veil. Just like the high priest, when he went in on the Day of Atonement, he went in and he made a figure eight, forgave the blood seven times, and then came out on the other side. And see, he would be in the holy place where the ark, where the lampstand is. This is him coming out from behind the veil. Seven ages have been completed. Seven stars in his hand signifying seven new ages. And he is in full panoply. In his garments of beauty and glory. That is to say this. He is now fully revealed. Whereas in the beginning, because he doesn't have any clothes on, it just shows you that now he is fully hidden. The mystery is hidden. But now as it comes down through the ages and dispensations, at the end of the ages, now that mystery is fully revealed. And we in him can look back on the seven ages and see why Yahweh even made a creation in the first place. And we in him can now, with the seven stars, can now look forward.
Yes.
And we in him can determine how those ages will be like.
Yes.
See. See, that's the thing, see. Sanctum of Sanctorums. See. The power of transmutation. His eternal power being exercised. See. And these are things that we ask questions now and look. It's got to be more, and of course there is, because he said we'll be learning in ages to come, and he is infinity, and we are finite, you know, and we're just in a state now that we can't even comprehend to ask certain questions at this point. But here, it will all be revealed. Nothing will be hidden at this point. Okay? How you doing over there, dog? You picked this up. You have any questions?
I think she's a little lost. Be honest.
Not really, but maybe a tad. I don't know.
Huh? I'm just trying to make an assessment.
I mean, what do you mean by you can see this way, like, forward with the ages?
Forward?
Yeah, what do you mean by that? I understand all that until... By how?
Okay. That's a fair question, I think. Yeah, okay. Revelations 19 to 10, I'm thinking. That's it.
Revelations 19:10. And I fell at his feet to worship him. And he said unto me, See thou do it not. I am thy fellow servant, and of thy brethren that have the testimony of Yahshua. Worship Yahweh. For the testimony of Yahshua is the spirit of prophecy.
Okay. The testimony of Yahshua is the spirit of prophecy. Now the reason why John writes that, because he's looking back. He's looking back at Moses and the prophets. Right. The scripture says in Isaiah, to the law and to the testimony, they speak not according to this word. It's because there's no light in them. See, the first five books of the Bible, Moses wrote. Genesis, Exodus, Numbers, Leviticus, Deuteronomy. The prophets, when they made prophecies, they had to draw out from what Moses wrote in those five books to make a prophecy on what the Messiah would do, both in his ministry and beyond. John, on the Isle of Patmos, who wrote the book of Revelation, is confirming what Moses and the prophets wrote. Our founder, Henry Clifford Kinley, who received this great panoramic vision, is really encompassing both John and Moses, which is why we have all these charts that you see all around. It's encompassing that. Now, the spirit of prophecy is simply this. The prophets knew what Yahshua was going to do because they knew what Moses wrote, and they based everything on what Moses wrote. For example, Moses wrote about the man Adam. He wrote about the man Adam being born on, created on the sixth day, surrounded by animals. Okay? So the prophets prophesied that. Yahshua fulfilled that when he came and was born in Bethlehem in a stable in a manger, surrounded by animals. That's a fulfillment of that. Or like when the prophets wrote about David. You know, how David came from the tribe of Judah. He was from the town of Bethlehem. So Yahshua fulfilling that, he had to come from the tribe of Judah, and he was born in Bethlehem. Okay? So the prophets, understanding the scriptures, one, they understand that the scriptures cannot be broken, and two, that they're pointing to the Messiah. We, at this juncture of history, can look back and can see how the law and the prophets pointed to the Messiah, or how they testified to him. So if that being the case, and nothing has changed in principle, then likewise, we can tell you what's going to happen in the ages to come. Because one, we have a pattern to look at. Two, we have the scriptures, which cannot be broken, to look at as well, according to a pattern. So we can tell you what will happen in the ages to come. Just like we can tell you what happened in the ages past. We can tell you what happened in this age, even though none of us has ever been there. But based on the evidence that we have, we can tell you, okay, you know, there were giants back here, giant animals, one landmass, didn't rain. It lasted for 1,656 years. Tell you what's going on here. We can tell you what's happening now in the present. And because we understand the scriptures and the pattern, we can tell you what's going to happen here. And in the sixth age. And in the seventh. Because we can look at the pattern and tell you this is what's happening here at the gate. First step. Second step. Third step. Fourth step, the door. Fifth step, holy place. Sixth step, setting the fundamental veil. Seventh step, Ark of the Covenant. You can take these seven steps, like you can just apply it to the seven dispensations. You can apply it to the seven ages. It works the same way. It's all applicable. Here, let me show you something. This is something, Dr. I learned something. One of the first lectures I ever heard by Dr. Kinley was one of his last. And he said something that it had a profound effect on me because I had to really stop and think for a minute what he was really trying to tell me. And it's page 128. See, about the number 7. See. And see, if you understand this little formula, I think it will help you understand the purpose of Yahweh in operation. Volume 1, 128.
The number 7 in Jewish theology denotes perfection.
Come back up here, dude.
The Jews were commanded of Elohim to observe 7 events which end in a week of days,
mm-hmm.
week of weeks, week of years, week of years, week of millenniums, and a week of ages, mm-hmm. which are as follows.
Read.
1. There are 7 days in a week of days which ends with a 7th day Saturday.
See, now that's 7 days in a week that ends with a Sabbath day. Because 7 denotes perfection. 7 is the number of the pattern. See, 7 is the number of Yahweh operating in perfection. That's why there's 7 ages, 7 dispensations, 7 days. She's going to read it. Read.
2. There are 7 weeks and a week of weeks, which ends with the Feast of Pentecost.
Now see, 7 weeks and ends with the Feast of Weeks, which we know as Pentecost. 7 times 7 plus 1 equals 50. Because it's 50 days from Yahshua's resurrection to Pentecost, or 7 times 7 plus 1. It's operating in perfection. Okay, read.
3. There are 7 months in a week of month, which ends with the week of tabernacles.
See?
The Feast of Tabernacles.
See, now the Feast of Tabernacles. See, now that was when Solomon's temple was dedicated during the Feast of Tabernacles. See? After it had been built, it took 7 years for the building of Solomon's temple. And then 3 years for the dedication. And then it was dedicated in the Feast of Tabernacles, which happened to be the 7th feast of a series of feasts. That was the 7th feast day, 7th feast. There are 7 feasts that Yahweh gave. So that was the 7th one, the Feast of Tabernacles. Okay, continue.
4. There are 7 years and a week of years, which ends with a Sabbath year.
Okay, that ends with a what?
A Sabbath year.
A Sabbath year. Or sabbatical year, 7 years. See, every 7 years was a Sabbath year where they had to do rest. Okay, read.
5. There are a week of years, which ends with a year of Jubilee.
See, or 7 times 7 years plus 1. Mm-hmm. See, it's just a bigger version of what we said about Pentecost, except it's in years. 7 times 7 years, which is 49 plus 1 or 50, that would be a Jubilee. Okay, the Israelites celebrated their first Jubilee 10 years after the death of Joshua. See, Joshua came up here and he conquered the Canaan's land for 40 years. He lived to be 110. After his death, 10 years later, they celebrated their first Jubilee because then that marked them being 50 years in this land.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, read.
6. There are 7 millenniums and a week of millenniums, which ends with a Sabbath of immortality.
That's what I was telling you about over here. Sabbath of immortality. Here. Okay? All right, read.
7. There are 7 ages and a week of ages, which ends with the completion of the purpose of Yahweh before ushering a new order of things, as Yahweh is eternal.
Okay, that's the completion. See, that's what's over here, because see, once he comes, the high priest comes up here, here's the Sabbath. It's all in all. He's in the 7th age. Now he's got to come out from behind the veil of inscrutability, and see here, 7 ages are now completed. And 7 ages are now ready to be sown. New ages, 7 stars are ready to be sown. Yahweh is now fully revealed. Revealed to who? His children, his offspring. Who else is here? You see just, who else is here?
Yahweh.
See, you see the 12, this breastplate of the 12. See, that's us on here.
That's right.
That's us. We are on him, we are in him, we're with him. See, we are following him. We are following him back into the garden. Following our hope.
Mm-hmm.
For that which is seen is not hope. But now once we seek him, oh, now we're going to follow our hope back into the garden. Just like we followed the man out of the garden, now we got to follow the man back into the garden.
Right.
Just as likewise, we will follow the same man into a new set of ages. See? Keep reading.
There are other references of seven, such as 7 days of creation.
Mm-hmm.
Seven priests with seven trumpets, seven branch candlestick,
mm-hmm.
Solomon's temple was 7 years in building, the blood was sprinkled 7 times before the mercy seat, there were 7 feasts of Yahweh which lasted 7 days each, the book of Revelation was addressed to the 7 assemblies,
mm-hmm.
There are 7 spirits before the throne of God, 7 stars, 7 seals, 7 angels, 7 trumpets, 7 vials, 7 heads, 7 crowns, 7 thunders, 7 eyes. There are many other references. 7 denoting perfection.
Okay. All right.
What are the 7 assemblies?
The 7 assemblies in Asia that John wrote to.
Oh, right.
Ezekiel, the 1st chapter.
Ezekiel 1 and 3. The word of Yahweh came expressly unto Ezekiel the priest, the son of Buzi, in the land of the Chaldeans, by the river Shabar, and the hand of Yahweh was there upon him. And I looked, and behold, a whirlwind came out of north, a great cloud, and a fire enfolding itself, and a brightness was about it, and out of the midst thereof, as the color of amber, out of the midst of the fire. Also out of the midst thereof came the likeness of 4 living creatures, and there was their appearance, they had the likeness of a man. And every one had 4 faces, and every one had 4 wings. And their feet were straight feet, and the sole of their feet was like the sole of a calf's foot. And they sparkled like the color of varnished brass. And they had the hands of a man under their wings on their 4 sides. And they 4 had their faces and their wings. Their wings were joined one to another. They turned not when they went. They went every one straight forward. As for the likeness of their faces, they 4 had the face of a man and the face of a lion on the right side. And they 4 had the face of an ox on the left side. They 4 also had the face of an eagle. Thus were their faces, and their wings were stretched upward, 2 wings of every one were joined one to another, and to cover their bodies. And they went, every one straight forward, whether the spirit was to go, they went, and they turned not when they went. As for the likeness of the living creatures, their appearance was like burning coal of fire, and like the appearance of lamps. It went up and down among the living creatures, and the fire was bright, and out of the fire went forth lightning. And the living creatures ran and returned as the appearance of the flash of lightning. Now as I beheld the living creatures, behold, one wheeled upon the earth by the living creature with his 4 faces. The appearance of the wheel and their work was like unto the color of a pearl. And they 4 have 1 likeness. And their appearance and their work was as it were a wheel in the middle of a wheel.
Okay. Right there. Give her a break to read. Now I had that read because I wanted to show you what Ezekiel, see, this is another example where we're talking about to the law and to the testimony. Moses wrote about the tabernacle, right?
Mm-hmm.
And about the incense around the tabernacle.
Right.
So Ezekiel is confirming it. Now he's talking about a wheel in the midst of a wheel. Now here's a wheel here. This is the tabernacle. It has a court round about. Mm-hmm. That's a wheel. Here you have the Israelites encamped around the tabernacle. That too is like a wheel. So here you got the tabernacle, which is a wheel in the midst of another wheel, which is the camp of the Israelites. A wheel in the midst of a wheel. Mm-hmm. Here's another example of it. This is the ancient dispensations, our chronology chart. The ante, the post, and the present ages are ages in the realm of time with seven dispensations. That's a wheel right there. This wheel is in the midst of seven ages, which is a bigger wheel. You can even go even further. You can say the seven ages is a wheel in the midst of the biggest wheel of all, which is Yahweh, who is eternity, and everything abides within eternity. And eternity surrounds everything. That's the biggest wheel of all. Okay? A wheel in the midst of a wheel. What is that projecting? It's showing you, this is the center of the wheel. This is the heart. Dr. Kennedy said it best. Your heart is the throne of God. This is where it emanates from. This is where emanations come from. This is the center. Look here, draw a line. This is the center of you, of your body. People will think, no, this is the center of your heart. No, it's not. Your head is, because everything emanates from here. That includes your heartbeat.
That's right.
Your heart is regulated from here, not here.
That's right.
See? This is the most holy place. This is where everything originates from, emanates from, legislated from, authorized from, if you will, from a physical standpoint. See? Okay? Even to the point, from a physical standpoint, the nerves, because your nervous system starts here and it ends up in your feet. Your feet has, you know, what they call reflexology. Mm-hmm. So it has, you know, your nerve endings, you know, certain parts of your feet, you know, you can press on it and it affects certain parts of your body.
That's right.
See, because that's where it ends up at. See, the end being declared from the beginning. See? Go ahead, Dr. Samuel. All right, give him the mic. It's behind you there.
See, the head is the center, is the wheel, and everything orbitates in there. All your ideas, everything you think about, orbitate right there in the brain and the head.
Well, see, here's the thing. When we look at it from an esoteric point of view, see, you are body, soul, and spirit. See, here's the problem, and I tried to avoid this subject. But see, this thing, see here, this is the Holy Spirit operating in your body. All right, body, soul, spirit. All right, now, body, soul, spirit. The spirit that is in you is Elohim. Right? That's the spirit that's in you. There's no other spirit. There's no such thing as, well, your spirit. You know, or something like Satan comes along and takes over your spirit. There's no such thing as your spirit. And if you don't think so, we'll have it read. That's 1 Corinthians 6:19.
1 Corinthians 6:19. What? Know you not that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, which is in you, which you have of Yahweh, and you are not your own.
You are not your own. So where the hell did you get this idea about a throne at? You're a throne. You are not your own. So where do you get a throne at? Who put you in authority?
Come on.
I don't understand that.
Bring it home. Come on.
His spirit has no margins.
You can't even make your hair grow.
Really? That's right.
You can't add any stature to your height. The breath of life is not yours. Satan has no, he has no authority on that, over the breath of life. Otherwise, you wouldn't have these bodies out here in the graveyard. If you can do that. So this idea, well, Satan takes over your spirit, that is just ludicrous. It's nonsense. And it doesn't happen like that. There's only one person sitting on that throne, and no one, do you hear me? No one is dislodging him from that throne, which is his. Read.
Oh, for you are bought with a price. Therefore glorify Yahweh in your body and in your spirit, which are his.
Which are his. They're his.
They got nothing to do with it.
You emanate from it. See, Satan, see, the thing Satan does, he blocks his, your soul is here. You can't look up here because he's on the veil. He's blocking your view. He's got the rings of Saturn on the veil. He's got the moon down here helping him out. You ain't got a chance. Not until that Yahshua comes along and rip the veil out and a man appears up here. Otherwise, you got whoever you want up here. Whether it be the Pope or your guru, your preacher, your imam, your sensei, you. Blocking the view. And there's a war. There's a constant warring. Paul said it himself. He said, look, that which I would do, I don't. Why would you want to do it? Because the law of the Spirit in me wants me to do that, but evil's always present. What do you mean? I got a veil up. And it's messing with my mind, my soul, my consciousness, which is already carnal, which is already in a physical body. So what chance do I have?
None.
I'm going to look for something to justify it with.
Right.
I'm going to look for a law.
Mm-hmm.
To justify my carnal thoughts, my carnal intents.
That's what we do.
And we all did that.
I'm sure we do, still do it. Great justifier.
So, you know, that's the thing, see. You have to understand how this operates. We went over it the other day. If you don't understand Volume 1, you know, you ain't got no business reading about Volume 4 in the textbook. Mm-hmm. Dr. Killer tells you that. Because if you don't know how Elohim operates, then you're not going to understand how the mystery of the mystery operates. Because here's his imitation. Here's his grand imitation. So grand that, you know, even the very elect could be fooled if you don't know any better.
Mm-hmm.
If you're not aware.
Mm-hmm.
And especially now, you know, it's even more sharper than before. Let's see. Anybody got any questions? Anything to say? I'm about to gas on this.
I got something to say.
You want to say so?
Yeah.
All right, well, I don't think anything else I want to add to this before we can have a good 10 minutes. My exhortation simply is, look, the answers are in front of you. When you come to class every day and you look at these charts, the answers are staring right at you. The only thing you have to do is simply petition the oracle and inquire of these answers. If you engage, no, are you going to use that?
No, I'm saying
no. Okay. Just engage the charts. That's the only thing I'm saying. Engage these charts. Go through them. And the more you go through them, the more they will teach you things. They will show you things that you didn't expect. But But if you don't engage them, don't expect Yahweh to, I mean, Yahweh will show you things. Yahweh is no respecter of person. But Yahweh loves those who really inquire, who really want to know. He loves those who are importunists, if you will. See, those who are importunists, you know, that just keep bugging him about it. He's going to keep bugging him. Just keep pestering him. He's going to respond one way or another. Okay? And, okay, I'm through. Thank you very much. Oh, you have a question? Go ahead.
See, when I say the head, all the ideas and all the problems the body has, all be taken in the head, is taking, for example, the tabernacle, Moses' tabernacle, the most holy place where the Ark of Covenant was placed, and everything, the most important thing was right there in the most holy place, mm-hmm. where Yahweh dwells.
Yes.
So now, in this time, we understand our body is where Yahweh dwells, and the most holy place is the head. And everything is the most important thing of the body is the head, where Yahweh dwells.
See, here's the thing, let me just put this here. I agree with you as far as, in the physical standpoint, the head operates the brain. But the soul is what occupies the body, but what occupies the soul? It's the spirit. See, and that's what control. Now, look here, body, soul, spirit. There's a door here. So that means there's an opening. There's an interface between the body and the soul. See, we do it all the time. I mean, I lift my arm. That's the proof of an interface between body and soul. My consciousness has some limited say-so over my body. That's signified by this door. Here, there's a veil here between soul and spirit. Now, if there's a veil here, then I don't know what's going on behind this veil. Though there is a law of the spirit of life there, and it does control and operate my body function as far as my breathing, my life, my blood, it operates all of that. I still have very little access or information on what's going on here. And this is within me. So if there's a veil up, then I'm in competition with someone on this veil who's vying for my attention. As I seek out that which is in me, something that's blocking me said, no, you need to look at me. Check me out. I'm what you want. What do you want? You want Muhammad? Bam, I can be Muhammad. You want Buddha? Bam, I can be Buddha. You want Krishna? Bam, I can be Krishna. You want to be up here? Yeah, I can be you. Be an atheist.
That's the veil.
That's the veil. It's the projection of all of our fleshly concepts that affects the rest of the whole system, soul and body. See, that's all I'm trying to say as far as us understanding. See, that's why here, and I had to deal with the other week, when you have the other plate 37. See, when you cover this plate, see, that's darkness. That's right. The veil that covers the whole world. But the preaching of the gospel is the light shining out of that darkness. And once it comes to the individual, then that light can be awakened in the individual and dissipate that darkness. See, that's why it's all an inward thing. And that's why it bothers me when I hear people make certain statements like, everybody got the Holy Spirit, or Satan sitting on your throne, or the Holy Spirit's got to be put in you. That's just, it's nonsense. It is nonsense. And I challenge anybody to disprove it. You can either come here or whatever. But that's just not so. It doesn't work like that. And I hear people say it all the time. Well, the Holy Spirit got to be put in you. It don't work like that. You have not read comparative exegetical analysis. And because of that, you started off wrong, and then you'll end up wrong. Just that simple. Now that's my challenge. All right. If you think you can come up to, if you think you can correct me, I don't mind correction. I don't mind correction, but just come with it right. That's all I'm saying.
Right.
Okay. I'm through because I want to give Joe a chance. Thank you.
All right. You only got a couple minutes.
Yeah. Well, we'll start on a little earlier.
Okay.
Okay.
That's okay. We good.
Okay.
I want to say something about Don, about the backers and the forwards. I don't think you got it, did you? Yes or no? You got it? I'm okay, I think so. Ain't gonna take but a minute. I'm on Colossians 1:26 real quick, and let me know when you got it. This is what you need to understand.
Got it.
Everything with Yahweh is right now. Not behind us, not in front of us. Everything with Yahweh is right now. Now, how do we know that and how do we understand that? Read.
Colossians 1:26. Even the mystery which have been hid from ages and from generations.
Now hold it. Even the mystery.
Right.
Which have been hidden from ages and what?
Generations.
And generations. That includes us.
Alright.
Alright. Read.
But now is made manifest.
But right now has been made manifest or made known.
Right.
Now, I'm talking about you, but when I use Moses to show forth the same principle that we were drawing up. At the time that Moses was at the burning bush, he was in the same state and condition you and I were in. Ain't nothing great about Moses. Let me just straighten that out. He's just like me and you. Before Yahweh appeared to him at the burning bush.
Right.
And the only thing he knew is the life he was living right now, right then, which was now, and the life that you're living right now. You follow what I'm saying? Don't know nothing about Yahweh, and neither did he. He didn't know his name. Don't know what he looked like. Never heard his voice or his shape. I'm talking about Moses, just like you right now. Mm-hmm. Now, in order for Yahweh to reveal himself, he had to reveal himself to the man. And the man I'm talking about right now is Moses. Now, Moses only you can't live before you live. Am I making sense? Mm-hmm. You can't move ahead of where you are. Mm-hmm. In other words, you ain't going to be, if you're 21 now, you're not 22 today. You're still 21. Right. So at this time, Moses is 80 years old, and he don't know anything that's going forth. Right. About the Red Sea, about the Paschal Lamb, none of that. Do you understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So Yahweh appeared to him in that cloud right then.
Right.
But he took him back. That is, into the realm of eternity.
Right.
And then he showed him what went on before.
There you go.
He showed him the origin of the creation, the one that he's living in right now.
Mm-hmm.
He showed him the origins of the water that he was drinking right then.
Mm-hmm.
He showed him how the animals and all that came in right then as he caught him up in that body.
That's right.
That is in the realm of eternity. But it happened right then. The Father said that this was a vision he was having. But it was going on within Moses and not without Moses. Why? Because you're Yahweh. And everything with Yahweh is right now. So when Moses went up, got caught up in that vision, you see, and then he came forth. I'm talking about Yahweh up here within the cloud. Then Moses began to understand what's going on with him, because this is the origin and the beginning of creation, talking about the shape and form. But Moses understood that right then, because Yahweh appeared to him within his consciousness and took him all the way back. Now, I ain't got time. Here come Yahshua Messiah at the end of the age. Those folks were still in the same state and condition that Moses was in prior to the end of Yahshua Messiah coming in.
Mm-hmm.
But everything with Yahweh is right now.
Right now.
I'm saying all that to say this. If the man died in his consciousness, you got to pick him up in his conscience.
Right.
So Yahweh went to the man's consciousness, caught him up, into the realm of eternity, took him back in time, that is, in the realm of eternity, and then brought him forth right back to where he was, and then he continued to live right on.
Right.
You understand? Now, when Moses went back there, you see, he began to understand now what's happening right now with the people, because Yahweh showed him what happened back there with Adam. What do you mean? When Adam, when Moses saw the transgression on his third trip, then he understood why the children of Israel behaved the way they behaved.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
It's just like me. My dad was a weekend alcoholic. That's the very reason why I don't drink. Because he was a weekend alcoholic and he had the complete fool on the weekend. Love my father. But that's what he did. Drank on the job, worked on the job, driving drunk, all that. That's the very reason why I don't drink. Now the question is, have I had a drink? Of course I have. Have I been drunk? Yes, I have when I was a young kid.
Mm-hmm.
You see, but when I understood by experiencing that, I don't do any of that anymore. Haven't drank in years. I can't even count. 30-something years, maybe 40 years. Long time ago, back in my 20s, maybe my early 30s. But the point is, I had to look back at what happened in my life to understand what's going on right now in my life, and as I move forward, I declare what shall be as I'm moving forward.
Mm-hmm.
And in this particular case, I choose not to drink.
Right.
But I got to deal with this another day. But anyway, what I want to show you that Yahweh, you right now, everything with Yahweh is right now.
Right now.
And He within you, take you back and show you. But then also, he showed you what's coming up.
Right.
You see? And that's how Moses was able to move forward, and that's how you move forward.
Mm.
Right now.
Right.
Hallelujah. I can do that gentle stuff.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that. That concludes tonight's lecture. Are there any announcements? No announcements? All donations can be had by Dr. Eunice Reiser. We have classes here Mondays. Mondays and Tuesdays. Sundays and Tuesdays.
Sunday
and
Tuesday, Friday, and Sunday.
Sundays 11 to 1, Tuesdays and Fridays 7:30 to 9:30. Okay, we have a Spanish class. It'll be first Sunday of the month. Okay, this all stands for doxology. Did I forget something? Now to Him that is able to keep you from falling, present you fall with the presence with exceeding joy. To all of us, all of our Savior, to Yahshua, Sarasar, glory, majesty, dominion, power, both for all time, now and ever, let's all say,
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, that's what these lectures do to you.
I talked to Lord where he kicked.
What did he say?
Doctor said he might need another surgery.
On the throat?
He told me on the 11th.
Is he going back to Vegas?
Where did he have a surgery done?
He had surgery in Vegas.
Wasn't that
UCLA? I thought he had it in Vegas.
No, I was out here somewhere.
Hmm?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
They went to Vegas for consultation.
Natural report. He said I thought I sent it in. Then he told me, I said, well, how the hell are you doing? And he told me, well, my doctor said,
I thought in Vegas only casinos.
Why can't we just pick him up and bring him to class
and take him? I don't know what's going on. I don't know. He ain't because he said, I'll keep him warm. He never keeps us warm.
I give what you want.
He won't say nothing.
No, we can't talk, so I texted him.
Why you want that right? I ain't got this because somebody picked me up.
You can pick me. No, no. I have no problem picking him up.
and taking him home. All you gonna do? Yeah, he knows that. He know we all will.
Maybe he
yeah. But he said he don't feel good. He said he did this something to the effect.